How do you define sin? Sin is wherever you are harming yourself and harming your loved ones.
Okay.
So if you think about it in that way, yes, it is a sin.
Yeah. So even if suicide per se is not a sin, the act makes other people suffer, so even by that way it is a sin. You were going to say something.
It's another human being, one among us, so we have to be concerned.
Yeah. Yeah, you want to say something? You want to respond to all that? You don't, you're not convinced. Yeah, please.
I mean, telling something that you're sin, you're committing a sin is a judgment you're passing on the person.
Yeah.
He's just doing what he's doing.
Yeah, yeah. So is it, what are you, what is your final point? So it's okay, if it's not a sin, let him kill himself?
I mean, it has an issue of concerns, of reasons and stuff like that.
Okay.
But most of the time, it is defined as a sin. Basically in the Indian context. And which is why people sometimes don't like it.
Okay.
Which is against something like where you have the willingness to die, like euthanasia, for example.
Yeah.
It's also kind of a suicide.
Yeah.
Which is legal in certain places.
Yeah. Okay. I will not get into the complicated discussions about euthanasia at this point in time. I will... In fact, till now I never mentioned sin. I said it's a health problem. It's a... Yeah, all that. But you're saying... And I also said that in countries which are atheists, in fact in Sweden and Norway and all, nobody believes in God. I mean, they all churches are being converted into, you know, nightclubs and all that in many places. There is no sin, there is no concept of sin. Maybe 150 years ago the Christian church may have thought that it was a sin. But I told you a little while ago it's a global public health problem. In India what you're saying may be right, in Muslim countries maybe in... That is right. In Catholic countries, it may still be. In fact, later on, when I give you the rates, you find that countries which have strong religious beliefs, the suicide rates are less. Yes?
I think all our laws which are existing today are derived from religion.
That's right.
So the sin just translates into right and wrong in law, right?
Yeah.
Eventually.
Yeah.
So that would answer it.
Yeah. So consequently, as the society changes, laws also change. In our country, it's a punishable offense. We are one of the very few countries where attempted suicide is a punishable offense. In most other countries, it's a health problem. Okay, let me move on. Terms and definitions. Are there any terms that you have not understood when you read or when you discuss about suicide? No. Okay, then let me quickly go through this. Anytime deaths are notified from an official... perhaps you all know that in all countries in the world, including in our own country, there is a registrar general of births and deaths.
Yes.
All the deaths, all the births, I mean if somebody dies in your family, not suicide, but old person, within the next 7 days you are supposed to report it. If the person dies in the hospital informs. If the person dies out of old age, natural causes at home, you are supposed to go and report it in the corporation or the municipality or village office or wherever, and within a period of time they will issue a death certificate. In fact, the valid death certificate is a death certificate issued by the representative of the Registrar General of Births and Deaths. Similarly with birth, again birth, if it is not occurred in a hospital, you are supposed to go and register it in the local health department outlet. Now how do these agencies register deaths? There are broad categories. They are natural, that is all natural causes. Again, there are definitions, etc. I will not go into the details. Accidental, that is road traffic accidents, you fall from a tree, fall from this, that, or you know, number of things. Fire accident, third is homicidal, which again all of you know, murder. Somebody killing for, you know, either planned, unplanned, sometimes it is unplanned, you didn't intend to kill but you did something and in the process the person dies, that's homicide, and last is suicide. But one of the big problems is, especially in our country, especially when it is dowry related death, etc. Is it suicide, is it accident, or is it homicide? For example, if you any of you know people who work with the burns unit in Victoria Hospital. I know an organization in Bangalore called Vimochana which works with them. So very often the story is that this lady was cooking in a kerosene stove and suddenly it bursts. So it's an accident according to the report. We don't know what exactly happened. On many occasions, maybe the mother-in-law and the father-in-law and all the other people, I'm just making, not talking about any particular case, based on what I read in the newspaper, literally drive the person so crazy that ultimately the person goes and pours kerosene or does something and immolates herself. So typically it's a suicide, but it may be a homicide also because somebody has abetted that suicide. So the point I'm making is the boundary between accident, homicide and suicide is not very clear in many cases. And that is why sometimes cases which are registered as suicide is taken up because somebody complains and then it's a homicide. Sometimes police investigate homicide for a long time because there are complaints and ultimately they say that it is suicide. And at any point in time there would be one or two cases which are known to the media which comes in the newspaper every other day. I mean, I was following up a particular case about somebody in Calcutta who died in front of a train, but he was married to one of the industrial house's daughter. Is it suicide, accident, homicide? I don't know what happened. I stopped following this story. So the point, all that you need to remember is, some of them are very clear. I mean, if somebody dies in the road traffic accident, 99% of the time it's an accident. But then you see movies. You see, the villain threatens you, threatens you, saying that your son will be killed in a road traffic accident. So there are possibilities that it's a homicide. Anyway, you don't have to worry about it. We are not doing any policing course. It's a counseling course. So we will be bothered about people, their family members who are affected by suicide. Okay. I will quickly go through these because these are all very well understood, but I think you need to know, because in a typical case of suicide, except like already somebody said here that when you read in the paper, husband killed himself because the wife didn't make fish curry or something like that for dinner, that is only the last straw on the camel's back. There would have been lot. This is true of 99% of the cases. The media people like to give a nice caption. You will not read the newspaper if the caption is not very nice. Wife refused to cook fish curry, husband kills himself. All of us will read because it's very, very juicy. Husband and wife have been fighting for last 30 years and now this man killed himself. It's not interesting. The fact of the matter is close to what somebody said here, that a lot of these suicides, it's like the last straw on the camel's back. Not in all cases. There's something called impulsive suicide. Something, you read again in the paper that suddenly something occurred and the person fired by the boss went and jumped from the top. Anyway, usually there is when things are not going on all right, when you're depressed, when you face situations in life which are not going on very well, you fail in examination, you wanted to get married to somebody but it doesn't work, you belong to two different classes, castes or communities, your parents say no, etc., etc. Initially you say, what's the point in living? Life is not worth living. These are suicidal thoughts, suicidal ideation, suicidal intent, in progressively serious, increasing severity. Thought is just a thought. I believe that there would be very few people in this world who would not have thought of suicide as one of the alternatives at some point in their life. I don't want to ask you, I believe that it would be largely true. At some point, oh my God, why should I live? Why don't I commit suicide? Why don't I kill myself? But fortunately, it's only a momentary thought. So that's a suicidal thought. If this thought becomes recurring, going round and round in your mind again and again, disturbing you, then it becomes an ideation and then it becomes an intent. Oh, I must. This is the only way, nothing else is there. And then suicide behavior. Somebody said, don't they communicate? They certainly do communicate. In fact, at the end of your training program, you should be able to pick up these things much better than other people. Nobody ever kills themselves without giving a message or a gesture, communicating a gesture. Many people, when you analyze text messages sent by people who kill themselves, suddenly it becomes meaningful. Oh, this friend last night wrote to me, oh, I wish you all the best, etc. As if it's their last message to you. When you read it, it doesn't appear like that. You see, next day you hear from somebody, oh, she killed herself, and then not only the previous 1 week, everything was communicative of suicide. So suicidal behavior is person talking about ending life. Sometimes it's not about themselves. Oh, I wish the world ended. I wish this occurred. I wish that occurred, etc. Suicidal gestures, suicidal communication, all these are similar kinds of things. Depending on the person's personality, some people express through gestures, some people express through notes, and some people express in the Western world where a lot more people communicate through social media. In fact, in Australia, 2-3 years ago, there were 2 girls who were missing from school, and then there was a countrywide hunt for these people. You know, very rich country, they will send helicopters to see the bush area where, and ultimately after a week or so, they found the bodies of 2 people, I think, hanging in the bush away from, you know, Melbourne in Victoria. And they were school girls, late teens, I think 16 or 17 or so. They had got into some pact and they killed themselves. But 1 week prior to this, they are missing. In their, I think it's a Facebook or whatever, one of those sites, they themselves have written RIP, rest in peace, and a little note. But nobody notices it. I mean, although maybe some of their friends may have noticed it, but they would have thought it's a prank or whatever. The point I'm making is that all over the world, people communicate about their unhappiness, distress in a variety of ways. And that's very important, because all suicide prevention work is based on picking up people who potentially have these kinds of problems. Of course, you don't go and ask, are you thinking of killing yourself? You have to, the skill that you develop is to pick up those kinds of gestures, communication, etc. Then, of course, there is a definitive thing which is called an attempt. At that time, of course, it's open. Maybe the family would say, oh, he thought it was, you know, cough mixture, but he took Tictendi or pesticide, which was used for the garden weeds, but you know, it was an accident, but everybody knows that it was a suicide letter. So suicide attempt is a conscious, deliberate effort to end one's life. Today, we know that in all cases, particularly in young people, doing something like that need not always mean the person wanted to end their life. It might be a cry for help, it might be a message that you want to communicate, it might be taking revenge on somebody whom you like to make him feel sad. You don't want to die, but you want the other person to feel sad for you. So that is why today, suicide attempt means that there is a value added to it. The person wanted to commit suicide. And that is why there is a neutral term today, which is called deliberate self-harm. All that the person has done is, he has deliberately harmed himself. Whether it was a communication, whether it was taking revenge, it was mother scolded the son so much, so the boy wanted the mother to feel sorry for him, so he took half a dozen tablets. He didn't want to die. He wants to live his life and enjoy his life. So that is not a suicide attempt. That's a deliberate self-harm. Okay? So today, the neutral term for any kind of attempts, or when you hear people slashing wrists or people doing very taking tablets, taking other compounds, etc., that's the commonest thing, then it is deliberate self-harm, or otherwise also referred to as DSL. Parasuicide is a term which is used in some countries for attempted suicide, when you know that the person's intention was to kill himself. Any questions till now? Okay. Yes.
Parasuicide?
Yeah.
Parasuicide
is a term for suicidal attempt, which in some countries they use the term parasuicide. It appears a little more suicide, parasuicide. Para means similar to. It is just that. It is in England, but today that is not a very fashionable or widely used term. But I'm just giving it because if you read some book or some literature and you come about parasuicide, you may start wondering what is this parasuicide. It's a synonymous term for suicide attempt. Today what is most commonly used is deliberate self-harm. Even in medical records they write deliberate self-harm. Unless you have evidence to say that he was depressed or he wanted to kill himself, had communicated this, you don't say it's a suicide letter. It may have been just, you know, an impulsive act, or You wanted to teach somebody a lesson and that's why you did that. Okay? Now, those of you who are very computer savvy and you want to get a lot more details about India, about the summary of which I am going to tell you, in India, all the suicide data is official data, is ultimately stored and recorded by the National Crime Records Bureau. It's called NCRB. They have a website. Till the previous year, they have a number of things. If you want to know how many rapes were concerned, I mean, every paper gives all details. It's not that they have all conducted a survey and got it. You go to the National Crime Records Bureau website, you will get that data. Everything which is recorded in the police, each state-wise, district-wise, you will get all the data. Hundreds of tables. Somebody who is interested to do further work on any of these, road traffic accidents, accidents, suicides, homicides, crime, everything is there. But the reason why I mentioned this is, in India today, even today, suicide and attempted suicide is recorded along with crime, you know. The other tables in that website are about murders, homicides, planned murders, unplanned murders, but there's a whole section on suicides and you will get a lot of data. Other terms which are used, psychological autopsy, verbal autopsy, and sociocultural autopsy. Sociocultural autopsy is not something which you will find in the literature very much. It's something which a colleague of mine in Bangalore in NIMHANS, Dr. Guraj, we used to do some research on suicide some years ago. And then we thought that in countries such as ours, more than psychological factors, there are sociocultural factors. Husband is a drunkard, he doesn't work, he comes and pesters the wife who works as a maid servant somewhere, you know, for money for him to drink, and ultimately she gets fed up, she wants the children to study, wants to use the money for that, but the husband comes and beats her, especially after drinking. This is a sociocultural problem, poverty, alcoholism, etc. Psychological autopsy means, do you know what a medico-legal autopsy is? All of you know. You do a postmortem. If somebody dies by one natural cause, you take the body to Bowring or Victoria or designated centers and they cut open the body to find out whether it was heart failure or it was water in the lungs or hemorrhage in the brain or whether he was hit by a rod at the back of the head or whatever it is. That is medico-legal autopsy. Psychological autopsy is a term which is used to describe the investigation that is done by anybody, usually done by researchers and psychologists and all that, or counselors, that a death has occurred in a family, it's a suicide. Then you recreate the story of this person over the previous 2 weeks, 2 months, etc. What happened? To know the repeated problems the person has had. You know, very often the media report is they just get, oh, this happened and they write. But psychological autopsy is a term given to the investigation. Investigation means not by the police, but by any counselor or therapist to help the rest of the family to find out what has happened. Verbal autopsy is a research method. I mean, every now and then you read about suicide rates in, National Crime Records Bureau as well as many other research publications, they say suicide rate in India is so much. Verbal autopsies, they go from house to house and inquire. Do you know anybody who killed themselves in your family or in your neighborhood? And they say, oh, 4 years ago, my neighbor's daughter killed. So you get all the details. That is verbal autopsy, psychosocial autopsy, psychological autopsy, and sociocultural autopsy. Sociocultural autopsy is, you know, farmer suicide. Lot of them are not because of any major depression. Depression may have been there, but it's the incidental. It is related to loans, it is related to failure of rainfalls and poor rates for crops, changing prices. You know, you may have read about the farmers in Vidarbha region of Maharashtra. They are called the cotton suicide. Cotton farmers about 2 years ago, you know, every other day used to kill themselves. It's related to international cotton prices, globalization, trade. So they are all sociocultural factors, you know. It's not the intense psychological factors. So this is again for your general understanding. I will stop after giving you the background about suicide situation in India. I told you that 14.5 is the global scenario and then the Indian scenario. Do you know which countries have the highest rates of suicide? Any idea? Anybody? Sweden. I think UK. UK.
Norway.
India. Okay, we can keep on listing that. Any countries where suicides are occurring much more frequently than before in the last 6 months to 1 year?
India.
India, of course, has always been there. There's a steady growth. Steady growth. It's not that sudden increase. It has been steadily increasing. But some countries in the world, in the past 6 months to 1 year.
UK,
US, no. China, Japan, no. Which is the country where, because of, you know, the currency fluctuations in the European market, Greece, Italy, Spain, southern European countries, which have huge debts, they are being asked by the European Union to control their spending. As a result, people are losing jobs, there's no welfare. So in the past 1 year, suicide rates are going up in Greece. To begin with, Greece, Spain, Italy, Ireland, these are all in the European Union. This is a consequence of the recession and the global financial crisis. I'm mentioning this because socio-cultural factors are very important. You lose jobs, you have no money, you are not getting your welfare benefits. Suicide is one of the consequences. Anyway, I'll tell you, you don't have to. Suicide rates are notoriously unreliable. So, because the rules which are followed, like in India, it is a crime records bureau, in some other country, it's a health department. There are no standard rules all over the world. And people tend to hide suicide because it's very stigmatized. If there is a suicide in one's family, they make every effort to hide it. It's not very good to say that somebody in the family committed suicide. Maybe the daughter will not get married. Even if the daughter is already married, still you will not say, because a granddaughter may not get married. Or it's not a good thing. So the so-called rates are unreliable, and usually the rates which are officially declared is an underestimation of the actual rates, including in countries such as Sweden and Norway, which are very advanced as far as recording etc. is concerned. Official rates may underestimate true rates by 20% to 100%. It varies. Worldwide variations in rates between countries and between regions in the same country. In India, for example, I'll tell you later on, the South has more suicides than the North. Okay? Rules and methods of reporting and assessment are variable. Suicide attracts stigma, and that's one of the reasons why it is very variable. So, to what extent are global and regional differences in suicide rates real? We don't know. Is it a function of the recording practices? We do know that some rates which are different are real. All the Muslim countries in the world have very low rates. It's not only poor reporting, but Muslim countries, because maybe they believe it's a sin, it's whatever. Similarly, traditionally Catholic countries have lower rates. Okay? So some of the real, some of the differences are real, some of them may be an artifact of the recording practices, etc. Highest rates are found in, some of you answered Sweden, Norway, etc. Some 30 years ago, it was true. But now, is it going to be distributed? No problem, you can. Thank you. We'll anyway break. I'll just finish this section and break. Today, the highest rates are in the countries which were part of the USSR, Union of the Soviet Socialist Republic. They are now called, you know, Ukraine, Belarus, Moldova, all the small states which were part of, they are called the Eastern European Bloc. They are former communist countries. About 20 years back, the communism collapsed. When communism was there, they had some kind of a welfare state. After it collapsed, it had the capitalist market economy and big fluctuations, etc. Today, in the last 10-15 years, the highest rates are in many of the former countries of the Soviet bloc. Lowest rates are found mostly in Latin America, Muslim countries, and some of the Asian countries, like Buddhist countries, also have low rates.
In the Muslim country or in the Catholic country, is it because possibly they don't say it.
Yeah,
but they're not recorded.
One at a time. We don't know. That's why I told you that it's not. I mean, that's why I made the point that they are notoriously unreliable. We all these factors may be true. So when we don't know, your guess is as good as her guess and my guess. You wanted to say.
My point was, when a person wants to commit, does he think about religion and not when he's trying
to? Very, very important question. We'll come to that. We'll come to that. These are the countries. I'll just close this after the international section. These are the Eastern Lithuania, Estonia, Latvia, Belarus. Some of you may not have even heard the names of these countries. They're small countries, part of the former Soviet bloc. Russian Federation, Hungary, Finland, Sri Lanka. These are all island countries, Japan, Sri Lanka. That's not religion, that's, we don't know why, but Sri Lanka had a high rate, there used to be a civil war, rates are coming down. Japan always had high rates, Mauritius, Cuba, etc. Now countries with low rates, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Philippines is a Catholic country, Brazil, Colombia, they are all. Greece used to have low rate and that is why it has come into the international news. Now the rates are going up. I think I'll stop here because tea has come and we can all stretch our legs as 10 minutes we'll break. And